Hello, gang. It's Saturday night, the 30th of April 2016, and a warm welcome along to our occasional late night broadcast, Spoils and Girls. Yes, we're here late at night, and where there's a multitude of ways, dear, a multitude of ways that you can watch this evening, either by Facebook, and no doubt in my mind that most of you will watch by Facebook, and indeed several of you are there already. Nephew Gary Butler is here. whom I have just come back off holiday with. Hello, Gary. Our good friend Adam the plumber. Adam, have you decided on a new name for your plumbing business yet? That's the question. Daniel Gannon is with us. He lives up north in Manchester. Don't you, Adam? Daniel are there. Hello, Daniel. And hello to Peter. Good evening, Peter. Kim Witt's up north as well, northeast in Lincolnshire. It's so flat there. I wish my chest was as flat as it is in Lincolnshire, dear. And Jerry's there as well. Hello to Jerry as well. And little Kelly. We're all together. Oh, what's that flashing across the screen? Little love hearts. I haven't seen those before. They're new. Feel free to... Actually, you can call in now if you want to, Adam. I haven't started anything. So if you want to call in now, you're welcome to do so. Now, here's how the calling works. Oh, just to let you know, you can also watch on YouTube, boys and girls. Now, if you watch on YouTube, the picture is much better. It's much wider and all that. Okay? But you can't... I can't see messages coming up in front of me. So don't leave a message on the YouTube thing because there's too much to watch. I did have a little think about doing on the Periscope as well today. But that would be extremely complex. Oh, I like that. You see the little thing? Can you see the little things going across if you're watching on Facebook? Can you actually see the little... what do you call them? Icons? No. Emocons. Can you see those going across when someone starts to push little buttons and things like that? I don't know. Feel free to share the show if you want to share on your own wall. That'd be quite nice to have a few more people in. Peter says no. Okay, Peter, I didn't know that, whether you could not. So that's... Oh, you can. Now Peter says you can. Oh, do make your mind up, Peter. Honestly, dear, you're worse than a woman in a shop. Oh, that's really sexist. No, it's not sexist. It's called comedy, dears. Comedy. Now, Adam, when you're ready to call in, I can only take one call at a time, boys and girls, just to let you know that Daniel's with us as well. Daniel's just down the road in Camberley. Hello, Daniel. So thank you, Mark. Yeah, you can see them all flying across there. So if you'd like to leave a message, or you'd like to call in, rather, I feel like an answer phone. I'm sounding like an answer phone today. If you'd like to call in, then feel free to do so. But once I'm on a call, I can't take another one or put one with... Well, I can join them together, but it all gets very messy then. So just one at a time, OK, my darlings? If there's someone on the phone, it means you can't call in. So, Adam, I'm ready to take your call either on Skype. We've got a Skype in. The Skype in is United Kingdom Talk, OK? All one word, United Kingdom Talk. Or you can call in. The phone number, it's a local London number, 020-8144-3477, OK? 020-8144-3477. I'm awaiting your call, young Adam. Shania said they went through Camberley last week. Oh, yes, did you see the big Tesco's and the Marks and Spencer's? Because Shania was just down the road for me. We were just... I bet you do, Peter. We like a mess. She was just down the road from me in Egham. Oh, it's posh there, dear. Well, they say it's posh. Actually, Ronnie's other half, Andy, was brought up in Egham. And I actually went out with her. I say I went out with her. I went on a little trip with someone from Egham many, many years ago. And they all make it out to be so posh, dear. And it's not. It's not, because I worked in one of the pubs down there just for a one-off on a bank holiday. Possibly last August bank holiday. So coming up to a year or so ago now. And it's not posh at all. Load of old rubbish, Egham. But it is quite nice there. It's quite, shall we say, affluent. They've got a bit of cash there, you know. They've got a bit of cash. Hello to Paza Aiboria. Ari. I can't say your name. Can I have a shortened version of your name, please, so that I can say it? Oh, you don't mind me asking that, do you? Is that a rude thing to say? Can I? Because I'm not quite sure how to say your name. Let me try it again. Where is it now? Right at the top there. Pazaribo. Is that all right? Callum, look at him in the suit. I saw the photographs. Makes a change for you to wear a suit, doesn't it? Rather than the old tracksuit bottoms like your dad. Honestly. Callum says the best bit of being in Egham was there was a Ferrari garage, only a 10-minute walk down from the road. I know that Ferrari garage. Oh, I often go in there, you know. I go in there and pretend. I show great interest. Oh, I don't know if I want that one, really. And you know, the secret is... the secret is... Never go in there asking prices. Once you start asking prices, they know you haven't got much money, right? That's the secret to doing anything posh at all. Never, ever ask about the price. It's like when you go into a posh shop or something. Never ask the prices. Just go in there and start looking. You know, don't ask the prices. That's a secret. Kelly Kim, hello to Kelly Kim, who's on the train, darling. Oh, choo-choo. Kelly Kim's on the train. I'm not going to be a chav and put the sound on, but I'm just waving hello. Turn it on, Kelly Kim. Go on, put the sound on. Annoy that, you know those people you've got in there playing rap music really loudly. Well, just turn me up, dear. Hello, Kelly Kim. Turn the sound up. Honestly, how can you be sitting there watching me and not listening to me? I think it's rude. Rude is the word you're looking for. I'm very pleased to say that Shania did a little bit of shopping in Waitrose while she was in Egham. Did you not find that a completely different experience to what you're used to? Eh? I think you might have done. Hello to Janet, who's in Arizona, US of A. Hello, Janet. Are you one of the, are you one of the Manilow girls? I can't remember, because we've got some more Manilow news. Oh, yes. Now, if you've been watching my show, come on, turn it on, dear. Turn the sound on, Kelly Kim. God's sake. Now, buying a caravan. Thank you, Gary. I'll come on to that a little bit later. We're waiting for Adam to ring. He said he'd be 1 minute. How rude to be late. I can't bear lateness, dear. Come on. Chop, chop, Adam. I hope you're not sitting on the toilet watching this show. I should be very disappointed if you are. I don't agree with people sitting on the toilet watching this particular programme. Yes. We're waiting for Adam to call in. See, I don't really want to start something now before Adam calls in. If I start something before you call in, Adam, you'll have to wait for me to finish the story. And you know that can go on and on forever and ever, dear. Ever and ever. Forever and ever and ever and ever I'll be the one. Janet is, of course, a friend from Craig Adams, listening or indeed watching via YouTube. Oh, I haven't checked that thing. Is that working all right, the whole YouTube thing? I think it is. I don't know. She's watching live on YouTube, which is cool. 020-8144-3477. Hello to Alan tonight, who is a regular correspondent and viewer to the show, aren't you? I'm so glad you enjoyed my short videos while I was on holiday. I think we're just going to the holiday thing now, really. Yes. Hello to Kiki D, who's watching with Purdy. Purdy. Purr. I can't do purring noises. Can you? Can you do that? Some people can do that, you know, they roll their R's. Oh, that's not too bad, is it? Oh, well, at last, Adam the plumber has bothered to pick up the phone. Good evening, Adam.
Good evening, dear. Sorry about that. I had to order dinner, dear.
You had to do what?
I had to order dinner. I was being demanded to order dinner by the other half.
Talk into the phone, dear. Into the phone.
I am talking into the phone.
You're
going to
start waving it around now, your head, so that we can't hear what you're saying, can you?
Can you hear me now?
Just about, dear. Can everyone hear Adam? Please say yes or no.
Can you hear me? Testing,
yes,
testing.
We can,
one,
we
two,
can hear
three.
You now. I'll turn you up a bit this end as well. Hang on a minute. Turn you on my speaker. Because last time...
Turn me up.
Don't know if you remember, last time we did a show, I completely forgot to plug in the sound into the camera. And people,
that's right.
And of course, I didn't believe it. People were saying, "Oh, we can't hear you very well." And I'm like, "Well, there's nothing wrong here because I've got all sorts of meters going like this in front of me, like this, indicating to me that the sound's going out. If the meters weren't moving, I'd know there was something wrong." But yeah, there we are. So you're there. Good evening, Adam. How are you, dear?
I'm very well, thank you, Chris, for asking yourself.
Did you get the Did you see the show where someone... it was Chris, actually, in the USA. Oh, I can't remember. Where, is he Atlanta? Atlanta, possibly. Chris in the USA, who suggested those various names. Did you see those or not?
I did see some of those names, yes.
What did you think of those ones? Any good?
Still thinking about it at the moment. I'm toying with the idea of changing the K to a P. So instead of KWA, PWA. Plumbing with Adam.
Oh, plumbing with Adam. I've wondered where that was going then for a moment. I really did, dear. Plumbing with Adam. Well, that sounds all right, actually. It's fairly simple, isn't it? Is there anyone watching at the moment? Adam's got a plumbing business, which is at the moment KWA Plumbing Services. KWA Plumbing Services. But he's thinking of you doing a new name. So if anyone's got any suggestions this evening on a new name for Adam's plumbing business, please send them through now. You know, rack those brains. Ah, Deanna. Hello, Deanna. Deanna's one of the Manilow girls. We're going to be talking Barry Manilow a little bit later on, girls. We really are, dear. I shall refer to my notes, which I had here a minute ago. Yes, they are. Anyway, so how about this one? Peter says, piping with Adam. Do you like that one? Piping with Adam.
Piping with Adam. Interesting. Interesting.
What I would say is that I think you need to be careful not to restrict your services. So
no, because I am multi-skilled.
Yes. So
I've just come back from some painting today.
Yeah. So, I mean, I completely understand anyone would send in something that might be funny to do with a toilet. I can understand that. Oh, dear. 1 minute.
Nope.
Hang on. Sorry. You know what? I've forgotten. It's 10 o'clock, dear. It's 10 o'clock. I've got to go downstairs to take my pills. I forgot.
Oh, no.
Are you able to talk for a minute or two?
I am indeed, yes.
Can you see people's messages?
I can't at the moment, unfortunately. I'm on the device that normally watch you on.
Ah, OK. So, well, if you can talk for about a minute and a half, would you like to tell people how you started your plumbing business? You ready?
Yes. Go. Well, good evening, gang. My name's Adam, and as Chris rightly said, I am a plumber. I've been doing it since the age of about 16 years old. Was taught by my dad, actually, who was a plumbing and heating engineer. And when my dad started his apprenticeship, it was they just started building Heathrow, and he was an apprentice. And by the time he retired, it was actually Heathrow Terminal 5 they were working on. So career, as it were, and I sort of picked up plumbing off of my dad and was taught by him. Sadly, he's passed away now about 8 years ago, but I've carried on doing the plumbing. During the day, I do have a daytime job as well, just to fill in when I'm a little bit quiet on the plumbing side, and I work for British Rail, or Network Rail, I should say, as a plumber and drainage engineer. So I go around fixing the toilets and plumbing the station at the southeast.
There, I'm back.
Oh, you're back.
Carry on with the story. We're all listening to you, darling. You finish the story. Yep. Don't stop on my account.
Yeah, so I work for Network Rail during the daytime, and I sort of run my evening work, evenings and weekends. I like to do the plumbing and drainage and maintenance service for people. I run it in the evenings and weekends because obviously I do have a job during the day.
Yes.
But I like to run it in the evenings and weekends because it suits people, because they don't have to take time off work. And I don't charge any extra for that. I just do it at normal rates.
I'd like to verify that. I know you don't charge too much.
No, thank you.
Because you've done a couple of jobs for my two of my friends, actually. Well, one that I work with down at the Golden Lion, you fixed a dreadful drain problem there. The smell that was coming in there, but that was sorted out. Oh, that was middle last year now. That was ages ago now, wasn't it?
Yeah, it was. Yes, it was indeed. And had to replumb a few of the bits and pieces there and change all the pipe work around to get it to work. But that's all working lovely now. Yeah.
And did you not do a camera thing for someone?
Yeah, one of the ladies that comes down to one of your karaoke's.
Yes.
She had a problem with her drain system and didn't know what the problem was. So I have an inspection camera, and I popped that down to her drain and had a quick look and see if there was any problems.
But, how much does something like that cost?
Well, for a camera survey, they range. I mean, because I do it evenings, weekends, I roughly charge around about between 100 and 120 for a little camera survey.
How much?
And that includes a sort of little written report and the video itself of the actual drainage. Now, I don't have what they call...
I didn't hear what you said then, darling. How much did you say?
Oh, between 100 and 120.
Right, OK.
Which is fairly reasonable, because an average camera survey would cost you around about £200, but that is a full spec survey. I just give you a basic survey to show that there's no problems with the drainage, and I give you a basic layout sketch of how the drainage works,
okay,
which way the way it directs, you know, and stuff like that.
Well, I think the people that you did it for didn't come back to me and say, oh, it's a bit expensive. They were very impressed with your prices, dear. I think you need to put them up, love. And you cover the southeast, don't you?
Yeah, I cover London. I live in London, in southeast London. So I cover London. I'll go down as far as Brighton, over to Royal Berkshire and Bracknell.
Berkshire, around here, dear. Yes.
I'll always come down and have a look at your pipes.
Good. Here. Well, we've got a couple of comments here. Mark Whittle, hello, Mark, says, Adam's Professional Plumbing Services. Then you could have apps. I'm not quite sure how apps would work with a plumbing service. Other than be a sort of elongated email thing that would pass on an email. But that's Mark's thoughts there. Hello to Laura. Mm-hmm. She's with us this evening. Good evening, Laura. One of our karaoke singers from Sunday night. Incidentally, there's no karaoke tomorrow night. Just to let you know, at the Golden Line, no karaoke tomorrow. Because they got a bank holiday, they got a bit of a band thing going on tomorrow, so that's fantastic.
What will you do with yourself, Mr. Reardon?
What am I going to do tomorrow night? I might well just do another chat show. I haven't decided yet. No, not decided.
Or you could be, a good boy and come down singing at my church.
I mean, it may be that the old Chris Reardon red. Hang on, I've just dropped everything. The Chris Reardon red phone will ring. Oh, hello, Chris. I fancied you for quite some time. Would you like to come out tomorrow? What's your Who is it? Yes, Barry. Oh, hello, Barry. What is that song? I'm sure I know that song in the background. Oh, it's just something I do in my spare time. OK, Barry. So I don't know what I'm doing tomorrow night. Shane says hello. He's in Manchester. Joyce says, Deanna, Bev and I are sitting in my Barry room. Well, I'm glad you are, Joyce. I'm glad you all sit in there, because I've got something in a minute for you lot. I've got something in a minute now. You know what's been going on, Adam?
Mm.
Oh, I'll do that in a minute. I'll do that in a minute. So you've not got any name sorted yet then?
Not as yet, no. I'm still debating on it at the moment.
And, yeah.
We'll get there eventually and we'll work something out. I want to expand a bit more and do more of the evening weekend work, you know.
I'm sure you've got quite a few people suggesting names to you. But as I was saying, you know, it's all very well having like a funny toilet type name, you know, like... Yeah. Flush down with Adam, but then people could think that you only fix toilets.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, there's a Brighton-based company that are gay friendly.
Yes,
that's called Ubenders.
Ubenders, you see? No, I think they'd be losing work with a name like that.
You know, I don't like that.
Are you going to start collecting? Number plates like they do for Pimlico plumbers. He's got some very, very expensive number plates, isn't he?
He has, yeah.
I've seen a load of them, like Lou 1 and Cistern 7 and things like that. You must have paid an arm and a leg for those.
But, well, you see, the way that they work is the guys are actually self-employed and they just rent the vehicles off of Pimlico plumbers, as far as I understand how it works, and then they just work, you know, they just get the work, but they have to be able to a certain caliber of person in standard, you know, sort of turning up in suits and sort of almost, you know, turning up on the floor.
Yes.
I mean, I used to work for a drainage company many years ago, I can name you if you like. And we used to have to put a doormat down and sort of show the prices before we actually done any work. And right. I didn't like that at all.
Okay. He doesn't do that, no?
No, no. He doesn't do that. But I used to work for a drainage company.
Oh, right. Yeah.
That used to lay a doormat down when we came in and sort of lay blankets down on the floor.
That's good, that is. No, I'm impressed with that. You know,
well, it
workmen
is,
that
it
make
is,
it nice
until,
and tidy.
Until you get, but the problem is, the thing was, what we had to do was we had to upsell and also, say I came around to your working for this company.
Yes.
And you had a burst pipe. I would not touch that burst pipe until you had signed the agreement that you were going to pay and that the price was okay.
Right.
I wouldn't even turn the water off. So you'd be getting flooded out, and until you agreed the price, so basically they were blackmailing you into signing up, you know, to get the job done first.
Do you know, I can't think of anything.
I can't think of
anything worse than a flood. That must be one of the worst. I mean, I'm sure you've seen some in your time.
Oh, I have. Doing.
What's
yeah.
the worst flood that you've ever been called out to? And what
the
was it caused
flood
by?
Was when I worked for Mid-Sussex Council, and it was an old people's home, and they had a tank in their loft. Now, this tank was what we call a Meccano tank. It's all bolted together in sections, and it stretched the full length of the building. Because if you think there's 80-odd independent living apartments.
Yes.
And this tank sort of stretched the full length of the building.
Oh, my
And
Lord.
One section of this cracked, and it went straight through this lady's house, apartment, into the communal room downstairs, and literally brought the whole ceiling down. The walls were all plasterable. They'd all come down. The poor lady, she had a cat. She actually cut up little carrier bags and put them on the cat's paws so it didn't get wet paws. And she was just literally soaked from head to toe. This tank had literally come through this, you know, the water had literally come through the ceiling.
Oh, how lovely. I like that.
Mm-hmm.
Funnily, you mentioned cats like that. I've just been down to the the kitchen to have my peels, and I thought, time to empty the cat's tray, but I can't do that at the moment. Not while I'm doing the show. I mean, I could take you downstairs and you could watch me cleaning out the cat tray. There's a smell of cat wee downstairs at the moment, but it is enclosed in the cat tray. And it's not so bad now because I've got that little cat house, haven't I?
Mm-hmm. That's right. Yeah, I remember you getting that.
Don't know if I remember telling you now, but at first she wouldn't use it. So I took the top off. I took the top off, so it was just an open cat tray. And then she started using it. And then after a few days, I put the top back on and jammed the door open. Yes, it was you that suggested it, wasn't it? I jammed the door open, and now she goes in and out. The door is still jammed open. I don't really need
That's
to
That's why
close
I'm saying put it on a peg, because you can slowly lower it.
Yeah.
Until she gets used to it being closed.
So that's what I've done. And that's much better. There's not half the amount of little white stones all over the blooming kitchen floor now, dear.
Yeah,
although the Hoover does have to come out. The Hoover does have to come out every day now to get rid of little stones. There's only a few around her cat tray, whereas before they were going all over the blooming kitchen floor, dear.
Yes, I know what you mean. Well, as I say, with the cat litter that I suggested, my little boy, Afro,
what's his name?
10 years old. Afro.
Afro the cat, okay.
Afro the cat, yeah. It was going to be Aphrodite, but then we discovered it was a boy, so he got named Afro.
I love the idea of this.
He's pure white,
yeah,
with a black towel and a black splodge on his head.
Oh, bless. I mean, I just love the idea of that woman putting a little carrier bag, bits of carrier bags around the cat's paws so she don't get wet.
I know, because the cat wasn't... No, the cat didn't want to walk around because it was literally squelch, 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 you know.
Oh, bless him.
It took four of us to roll the carpet up and throw it out the window.
That actually reminds me of something which will bring me on to my next subject. But I'll let you go first, Adam. Keep thinking and let us know when you decide.
And Chris, just as an idea for you, if you want to do it one night, we can always do Adam and Chris's advice on the Chris Reardon United Kingdom talk show.
Adam and Chris's what?
advice line. So if somebody wants to phone up with a plumbing issue,
oh, yes,
or a DIY issue, then we can give them advice.
Oh, I like the idea of that, dear.
Like a little advice slot, you know, like that.
Adam and Chris's radio show. I mean, I don't know if I'm the right person, really, to be giving advice about
DIY. You're so good with your little DIY things, like your little camera stand.
Oh, you're having a laugh, aren't you? Let me tell you, that the wall directly in front of me, you can't see it because you're looking the other way, but the wall directly in front of me now has an array of computer monitors and cameras, and the reason I did that was because people get moaning because it wasn't on YouTube Live anymore. So now I do that again. Although I've got to tell you, I came up here at 8:30, and honestly, I had in my mind, well, we'll start sometime between 9:30 and 10:00. And eventually I decided on 10 o'clock. It wasn't until 9:50 until I was completely ready. Because I'm not doing it all the time, I can't remember what to switch on and what to switch off. Do you understand what I mean? You know, when you haven't done stuff for ages. So it's quite difficult to remember. But nevertheless, so everything's on now and it's working. But in front of me...
Just remember one thing, Chris.
Yes?
Air conditioning controller to turn studio on and off.
Yes.
Keep them separate.
Do you remember I did that? Do you know that's year ago? That's got to be round about a year ago today, round about. I've got two remote controls here. Let me show you, boys and girls. This is the air conditioning remote control. That unit's been up there 10 years now. Do you know that?
I remember it on one of the shows.
Do you remember? Anyway, that turns that on and off. I've also got this, which is a remote control for all the sockets. If I press number 4 off, everything, literally everything, will go off in here. And I was doing this show all about the Black Cat, which is the place that I worked at, and I was there for 18 years. I left in 2007, I think it was 2007 I left.
Yep.
And it closed last year after many, many years. It was London's most famous drag venue, called the Black Cat. And we did two shows on it. And within 10 minutes, I picked up, I thought, oh, it's getting a bit hot in here. And I picked up the remote control, hit the button, and everything went off. And there was loads of people watching, weren't there? But they all stayed. Yep. I couldn't believe it when I eventually got it going again. Because it's, unfortunately, if you hit that off button, it's not a case of switching on and everything comes on again. No, you've got to go through a whole, routine of getting everything back on.
The problem's getting the Skype up again.
That's right. You've got to get everything. The computer has to restart. And at that time, I had an old computer. Now, this the one I'm on now, I've actually got... I changed my main computer back in January. And
that's right.
It's got one of those hybrid hard drives. So a bit of it's a flash memory and the other's the twirly turning thing, like an old one. And that starts a lot quicker. But I didn't have that then. And if everything goes off, to get it back on again takes between 10 and 15 minutes. And what surprised me is that everyone was still there. Or at least the numbers looked like it was everyone. It could have been another load of people, I don't know. But everyone was still there when I came back on. So as it burst back into life, I wish I'd burst into life at some point.
And one more thing for you, Chris, before I go quickly. Another little idea I've had. Why don't we one evening, just for a bit of fun, have the Chris Reid Knowledge Quiz for your super fans out there?
The Chris Reid Knowledge Quiz?
Yeah.
What do you mean?
Well, basically, the quiz will be on United Kingdom talk. So you can ask questions like, in which year did the mirror ball fall down? And many people can send their answers in.
I wouldn't know that.
Yeah, I do. I'm your official...
Well, there you go. Set
number one fan.
Set 20 questions when you've got some time. Okay?
Will do. I'll send them in.
Set 20 questions and and we'll do that at some point. The Chris Reid Knowledge Quiz.
Yeah, let's see how many people know all about you.
All right.
If they've been watching for many years. Pleasure again, as always, Chris. And talk to you soon.
All right, bye-bye now.
Bye-bye.
Cheerio, bye-bye now. All right, there we are. Adam the plumber talking to you there, boys and girls. He was saying about the little cat paws and think, oh, let's just do a couple of messages here. Laura says, oh, they're going to crazy golf tomorrow. Well, there was a crazy golf on the Haven Holiday Park curve that we've just been to. We didn't do that. Kiki Dean needs love. Advice about my love life. That's easy, Kiki. Just pay for it, darling. Just pay for it, my love. You don't want someone hanging around your neck all the time. Just go out and pay for the night or something. Something like that. Back to Haven Holidays. Yes. And Adam was saying that the little plastic bags around the cat's feet in the flood. It reminded me, actually, that, that's a good idea because, as you know, if you're a regular viewer to the show or correspondent, you'll know I've just been on a holiday with my nephew, Gary, and his lovely wife, Stacey, and Stacey's sister, Cheryl. Now, Cheryl is now the helper, care person. Okay, so they have three children. There's Harry, he's the little boy. I think he's three. There's Evie, she's a little girl, she's just turned four. And there's Olivia, who's about to turn 1 year old. Olivia is severely disabled. She has a very rare syndrome. I can't remember what it's called now, so but there's lots of bits wrong with her. So she has a carer, and her carer just happens to be Stacey's sister, Cheryl. So that's all of us there, and we've all just been on a holiday today. So they said, did you want to go? Yes, got me a caravan. I have my own prestige caravan, dear, with central heating, very warm. Oh, marvellously warm. Have you ever been in a caravan? Now, I know there's probably people watching this now who will think to themselves, oh, not a caravan. Now, I wasn't as bad as that. I had an open mind. But I have to tell you, it was nothing like I expected. Absolutely nothing like I expected. I expected some sort of large metal thing. Oh, cheerio, Laura. Bye-bye, darling. Large metal thing, which is a bit basic, really. No, completely wrong. They are like little houses. I'm absolutely serious. When you go in, you know, when you go on holiday, maybe you're in a hotel or you're in a guest house and you've like, you know, you've got a room in a hotel or a room in someone's house. And that's, oh, you're in someone's house. When you are in one, oh, it's, oh, Janet says she loves her. Oh, hang on, missed that then. Where's that gone now? There it is. Janet says road trips are fun. Not quite a road trip, Janet, if you're meaning what I'm thinking you're meaning. Not quite a road trip. These are static caravans, OK? So that they're more like mobile homes. I don't know if you know if a mobile home is the same in the US as it is here, but they literally are like little houses. You know, they're up on a couple of metal things, so they're raised off the ground. You have a kitchen come living area. In my particular caravan, I had a kitchen come living area, lovely wooden floors, two bedrooms. Of course, I only needed one. I had a toilet in my own bedroom, not actually, you know, a little room, an ensuite. That's an ensuite, and a separate. And another separate bathroom with a perfectly adequate shower and little wash basin. Peter says caravans are wicked for holidays. Yes, they are. And they really would. And it had central heating, radiators. And let me tell you, it was really cold. Unfortunately, the week we went, the wind had decided to turn around and come from the north, didn't it? You know, so it was blooming cold. There was a couple of days that we went out that we were very cold, but it didn't matter. You know, you can soon, you know, you get that cold, you just pop into a cafe for a cup of tea or something like that and warm up and then continue with your day out, don't you? And but this central heating in the caravan, honestly, you'd push the button and within 10 minutes you were nice and toasty and warm. There were two nights, it took me a little while to get used to how this heating worked in there. And there were two nights where I was in bed and I woke up about 2 or 3 in the morning. And I had to throw the duvet off. And there I was, laying completely naked. No, Peter, there was no one there for me, I'm afraid. Hello, Francesco. Nice to see you, Francesco. So I highly, highly recommend you try a caravan holiday. Now, they have different sort of layers of caravan. So you've got your standard. Now, the standard one, I believe, has heating only in the living room. I'm talking to my niece about that, Tracy, who's also done caravan holidays. She says if you're going on one of those, you want to take a fan heater with you, plug it in and just leave it on. And that'll sort it out. And then you sort of go up. It's like standard, luxury, prestige. And I think the one at the top is gold or platinum or something like that. I was in a prestige. So we had these radiators. And honestly, it was one morning. It was about 3 a.m. I was ever so hot. I threw off all my covers. But after a while, I worked out how to do that. What you have to do is close the door from the sort of living area between that and the bedroom and leave the heating on. So the bedroom will cool down and you don't have the radiator on in the bedroom or you have it on very low. And that worked very well after that. Now, on this... Hello, Dean. All right. Hello, Johnny. Johnny's there as well. Johnny Key is one of our very, very talented people that I know who plays the old ukulele and comes along to some of the karaoke nights. Hello, Johnny. Now, where were we going with that? I should have stayed on course then, shouldn't I? Heating. Where was it going? Heating. Throwing the bedroom clothes off. But highly recommended. Highly recommended. And I just wish that I'd gone on a caravan holiday 30 years ago. And cheap. Well, I mean, it is and it isn't. If you are comparing staying in a caravan with your family for a whole week to going abroad, my God, it's cheap. All right. So for a week, I think it would cost, depending on the time of year. So we went low season. I've got you on hold, Rory. I'll come to you in a second, my friend. All right. If you go sort of low season, I think we paid about £200 for Monday to Friday. Now, I was on my own in one caravan, so that would have cost me £200. But if I'd have taken two children and a wife or whatever, you know, or a friend or partner, you know, if there were five of you, it would still cost £200. You are paying for the caravan, not per person. That being said, even for me, right, even for me on my own, £200 for a holiday, to me, is not a lot of money, because as you well know, I've been to some wonderful places all over the world, right? I really have. I've been to Australia 5 times. I've been to Israel. I've been to the Caribbean. I've been to Italy. I've been to some wonderful places, but I can't honestly remember the last time I just spent £200 on a holiday. Not only that, the beauty of going in a caravan in this country is you leave your house, you get into your car, you drive, you arrive, and you're there. No mucking about in airports, waiting, spending a fortune, parking the car. You know, what's that now? £15 a day? You know, driving to the airport, hanging around in the airport for 2 or 3 hours, sitting on the plane for hours on end, bored to tears. And it doesn't matter if you're in the expensive seats, it's still bloody boring. Then you get off the other end, oh, waiting for your cases going round and round. And you know you can be there for an hour waiting for your case, queuing up to go through the customs, queuing up to go through the security, finding a cab outside to take you to a hotel that you've never been to before, and eventually getting there, checking into the... What a lot of mucking around. When all I have to do now that I've discovered, thank you very much to my niece and nephews, is caravan holidays. I leave the house, get in the car, drive for a few hours, I'm there. Bloody marvellous. I left here at 12 o'clock in the afternoon. I walked into the caravan at 20 past three. You can't go better than that. Rory's on the line. Hello, Rory.
Hello, how are you, Chris?
Lovely to hear you. Have you ever been caravanning?
I'd absolutely love to. I've had a lot of caravan stories, you know, and I've read a lot of those famous five stories and that sort of stuff. I have been away on long holidays, though. I did 29 hours awake once flying back from America.
Oh, Lord. No.
So I'd much rather prefer to do a caravan holiday. I've really enjoyed the videos, though, of you on the beach, and it really brings you into what goes on because you can even hear the wind against the camera. It's lovely. Yeah, so it brings you into that world, doesn't it?
That was really windy. I actually have some various devices, little microphones that I can clip on and things like that. But, you know, when you're on holiday, you don't want to start mucking around and plugging in various things, and so it's a little bit raw, but you know, it gave you the general idea. And as I say, Rory, I just wish that I'd been to a caravan years ago, because I had such a wonderful time. Not just the holiday. Or someone, Mark wants to know, what was the park entertainment like? Well, to be honest, Mark, we only went into the I'm assuming you mean the nighttime entertainment. Now, where's my thing here? There was nighttime entertainment. You could do bingo and things like that, but it was extremely quiet while we were there. You have to remember, it's the week before. What have I just tripped up on there? I've just got caught a wire. You don't want to know the spaghetti junction wires underneath there, Rory. It was extremely quiet. Put it this way. On the first night, we went into the entertainment hall, which is the ballroom, but they'd done away with the ball, Rory. I couldn't believe there wasn't a ballroom should have a ballroom, shouldn't it? But I should have one of those behind it. There's no ball in there. I was shocked. There was some sort of little thing going around flashing out coloured lights, but I'm sorry, dear. I may have to write a letter about that. We need a ballroom and a ball in a ballroom, don't we?
Well, you need a ball to have a ball.
I think so. So we went in there on the first night, and I suppose this entertainment centre would hold, I would say, 500 people, maybe 500 or 600 people. Put it this way, we went in there on the first night, we got in there about 9 o'clock, 20 people. There's only 20 people. That's how quiet it was. I mean, it was really quiet, but we didn't feel that was a problem. I certainly didn't think it was a problem, because of course we could just move around with ease. They had various shows on. When we got there, they'd actually just finished one of the shows, which I think there was a lady singing and stuff like that. And then they said there would be a quiz across in the bar over the road from the entertainment, because there was an entertainment venue, large hall, you know, with a bar at the back and loads of seats and tables. And then there was a bar come restaurant opposite it. And she said, if you wanted to carry on for the quiz, that would be in the bar opposite. So we went over there. Well, we got over there. There was only about 10 people left. But as I say, it didn't matter, Rory. Last night, we went. I did actually. Who was it asking? Mark, if you go back a little bit and have a look at Friday's video, I did do a little video of some of the show in there. I think they're called Yellow Coats at Haven Holidays.
Yeah, there were some dancers and some singers, weren't there? I think it was on the last night of your stay with your friends.
That's right. There was a lady singer. She went bad. There was a young lad singing as well, with black hair. He was about 22 years old, I think.
He was doing Lionel Richie, I think, from memory.
Yes, he had a really good voice, and he could dance, and he was entertaining, and I thought he was really good. I could see him on the television or something like that. So if you want to have a look at those little videos, the entertainment was good. I thought it was good, and we went swimming a couple of days. Again, we went swimming on Wednesday and Thursday morning. We went in there Wednesday morning. There's no one in the pool. No one.
Wasn't that with your sister and her family, wasn't it?
That's right, yeah. And fortunately, because people are very funny about you taking photos in swimming pools and all that business, fortunately, because there was no one in there, I said to the bloke, I said, as there's no one here, do you mind if we take some? He said, no problem at all. He said, yeah, just take some photos or videos as you see fit. So I was able to do some videos, and I actually took the camera into the pool. There's some quite good, just the way it all looks, you know. And I did a little bit of a conversation with Stacey, that's my nephew's wife, about the difficulties with little Olivia. I don't know if you saw Olivia, did you?
Is Olivia the disabled girl?
Yeah, she's got a feeding tube in her nose.
The tube. Yeah. A friend of mine, Greg, has that disability. Somebody I used to know at school, actually.
Oh, right, yes.
Yeah. It's I've seen that before. It was really interesting because when you were down by the sea, it reminded me because I've been down to Brighton earlier this week, and that brightened up my day. I can tell you, ha ha ha. But I love the sea. It's really nice to be there. And
we didn't go in the sea. Oh, it was cold that day. But that didn't seem to bother the two children. Oh, no. Can we get the buckets and spades, Mum? I thought, oh, no, we're not going on the beach, surely. And we did. But it was lovely. We went right up to the sea. And little Harry, he's the 3 years old. He got a bit close to the sea and then realised it was coming towards him. So he ran around quickly and escaped.
I just thought, you know, that Tara the cat's here. She's listening. She's sitting on the desk, wiggling her ears. I think she's becoming a United Kingdom talk fan as well, like me.
You reckon that's happening?
Yeah.
Mark, I've also got some more information. They do. There's an awful lot. If you've got a family, there's an awful lot for children to do. I mean, there really is. For example, they've got this program here, this like Monday to Friday type program, tells you what's going on and what have you. And Wednesday, it starts about 9 o'clock. Learn to swim in the indoor pool. Like you, there's no charge for these things. You just go along there. Also at 9 o'clock, mini sports in the sports drome. I think that's for the little ones. Archery coaching in the sports drome. It says here, Rise and Shine with the Seaside Squad at 10 o'clock, which is a family event, a fun breakfast experience in the sitting duck. So that sounds to me like a character breakfast, you know?
Right,
where
yeah.
You would sit down and be surrounded by people dressed up in animal costumes and that sort of thing, which would be great fun for the children.
Yeah,
10:30,
sure.
Polly's Swimmer Song for 0 to 4 years old. Great for little children in the live lounge. So that sounds like some sort of singing thing in the swimming pool, I would guess.
I remember, there's lots of activities that goes on in Fulham pools near where I am, you see.
Oh, right, yes.
And being a wheelchair user, I was in the water one day and a mother and her little boy came by and I heard the little boy say, Mummy, can disabled people swim? And I turned around and went, yes. And the mother burst out laughing.
Oh, and they don't know, do they? You know, yeah, one of those things. Yeah, I'd like to see you try and wheel your wheelchair along at the bottom.
I haven't fallen into the water yet, although I do appreciate very much the exercise of swimming, actually, very much.
And if you do, my advice would be to oil it very quickly afterwards because it'll all go rusty, a little bit like I have done. I've got a bit rusty, haven't I?
Yeah, you know what you were saying about heating earlier in caravans and things? I've got a very interesting short story about heating, funnily enough, because my mother's parents always kept their heating low.
Yes.
See, and when my parents were dating a long time ago, my father got so annoyed with it that when my grandparents left one evening for the wherever they were going,
my dad
took the thermostat off the wall and put the heating further forward than it displayed on the screen. So it was that, and that's my mother's parents, not my dad's parents, but my mum's parents.
That sounds like something I would do, to be honest, Rory, to save the money.
So it always looked as if it was 2 degrees, but actually it was several degrees hotter. And they never latched onto it. So actually, for the rest of their lives, they were in a much warmer house than they thought.
Well,
and they loved it.
When I went to my nephew and his wife's caravan was next to mine. And honestly, I don't know how hot. It was really hot in their caravan. She must have had it really high. And the funny thing is, they ran out of gas one night. I thought, well, that serves you right for having it on so high. Oh, my God, it was really hot in their caravan. Because they've got these two. They're not actually connected to the mains gas.
Yeah, right.
They've got these. Is it propane? Propane gas
in
a big orange, and the very big orange bottles. They were like massive oxygen cylinders. You know, they weren't the little bottles like that. These bottles were, I suppose, about 5 foot high, and there were two of them attached to each caravan. I suppose they just switched them over. You know, if one goes empty, and then you never run out. Mark says, excuse me, gas bottle. That's right, Mark. That's right. Oh, Ross is with us. Excuse me, I've got hiccups now. Ross is with us. Hello, Ross. He's in Norfolk. Hello, Ross. Mark says, I've been to Pontins and they are similar to Haven. They are fabulous cheap holidays for families, especially if you get the offers in the papers. Yeah, we used to go to Pontins all the time in the 70s, Mark. Oh, it was wonderful. Wonderful, wonderful holidays we had at Pontins. And let's have a look. There's another message there. So, oh, hello to Danny. Danny's in the USA. Hello, Danny. Nice to hear from you. Craig says... Craig, what's that got to do with holidays, mate? We're talking about holidays at the moment. Yeah, there was another message I saw there. I can't see it now. Yeah. Oh, Ross says, did you go to the Pontins in Hemsby? No, never been. Have I been to the one in Hemsby? I might have been, actually. I might have been. Not sure.
I've heard of Pontins. I wouldn't mind going on a cruise, mind you. Actually, that'd be quite nice.
Yes. Now, I'm sure there was another message I was going to read out then. I've not lost it somewhere. Just a minute. Let me see if I can find that. I like to get everyone's messages in. Let's see if I can bring it up there. They don't. Sometimes I lose them on the computer. They're on the phone, but you kind of lose them on the computer. Hang on, let me just turn this down a second and see if I can find that there. Or maybe there wasn't one. Sorry, I must have missed that. I think the Barry Manilow girls, Caligas. No, it wasn't Caligas, Johnny. No, it wasn't a blue bottle. It was an orange bottle. I'm sure it was propane or something like that. Yes.
Yeah.
I think Mark was. I think it was the thing about Pontins. I must have misread that. Hello to Tom Harris. Tom Harris is walking the length and breadth of the country at the moment, aren't you, Tom? Whereabouts are you now, Tom? Or maybe, have you got a mobile phone there? Maybe you can ring in and tell us in a minute, because we're doing phone calls tonight. It's all very exciting sitting here on a Saturday night. So much better than working in a sweaty club, dear. Full of smoke. Well, it's not full of smoke anymore, is it? So when you went on, where was it you last time you went on a caravan, Rory?
I don't remember. I can't remember actually going into a caravan.
That long ago,
I've got many friends who have used caravans and stuff. I've been on camps before, sort of activity camps and things like that.
Yeah, okay. I did notice that they're very adaptable for disabled people. They've got ramps and things that you can get in, so that's not a problem, is it, really? Although I would imagine the doors are a little bit narrow. I suppose they've got one with wide doors, have they? Oh, no, you could. You could go in the front. Because that's a double door.
Yeah, they make things more modern these days. Yeah. I mean, even things like buses and sort of local transport things are more standardised as being more accessible. Can I just say quickly, thank you very much for all the videos of the karaoke things. They bring you right into the room. They're really, really good.
I'm glad you're enjoying
Fantastic.
Those.
Fantastic.
Yeah, I'm glad you're enjoying those. We're doing those about three or four of those a week now. And it's fairly simple to actually just stick the camera up on a little tripod somewhere and just film everything that's going on. Lovely to talk to you, Rory, all right?
And you indeed, mate, and you indeed.
Cheerio now, my friend.
Cheerio.
There
Bye.
We are. Lovely Rory, who speaks to us in Fulham in southwest London. Very affluent there, dear. More affluent even than Egham. I have to tell you that. Hello to Dean. He says, I went to Blackpool. It was good there. Was that just in a hotel, Dean, or something like that? We're talking caravans tonight. And Tom is in Kincross in Scotland at the moment. So you must be almost completing your journey, aren't you? I would imagine. Yeah, you should be completing your journey. Just a second. Let me just type in something there. There we are. Sorry, I have to do 10 things at once. It would be so much easier, dear. So much easier if we had a producer here pushing buttons as I went. But there we are. That's one of those things. Now, we were talking about things that they have on this holiday, and they've got this whole list here. Look at this. At 12 o'clock, they've got this football academy thing. That's for the 10 to 16-year-olds. Guinness World Records, the qualifier. Aqua gliders in the indoor pool at 1. And it goes on, really, all the way through until 9:30 at night. They got bingo. We do like a bit of bingo. 6-1, 61. 7-2, 72. We like a bit of bingo. Ross says, Haven have special adapted caravans for disabled people with ramps, etc. So that's good. Right. I'm kind of losing my way here a little bit. Let's have a look. Ah, Craig says, my auntie, my mum and my grandma go to Hemsby for holiday and in Hemsby visit Two Ways Calf, and the owner is a relation of Bradley Walsh. Oh, I like Bradley Walsh. Now, there is someone who's talented. There are a few people who are still talented on the telly, although I don't know how many more are going to be left before they all die off. They're all disappearing at the moment, dear. All disappearing. Dean says, oh, Dean was in a caravan. Okay. Dean was in a caravan. Tom's got a month to go now on his holiday. Mark's going. Oh, you're going so early, Mike. Mark, do try and stay up with us, dear. We're only going to go for another hour. That's all. Just an hour. Is it too much to ask you to stay with me for another little old hour? Bingo. 7 of 9. Daniel wants to know if Skype is on. Yes, Skype is on. Why? It's for calling in, dear, not sending messages. Dear me. So that was the holiday, and I highly, highly recommend anyone who wants to go on a caravan holiday to just try it out, because it's fantastic. And spend, you know, to actually go up from standard to prestige, it isn't that much money, and it's cheap. It's cheap, and you get all that. Rory says, Bradley Walsh first presented the Wheel of Fortune. Oh, blimey, I can remember. That's a few years ago now, isn't it? So there we are. Call in if you want to. 020-8144-3477. 020-8144-3477. Now, regular viewers of the show will know I'm a great Barry Manilow fan. Love his music. I've been to several of his shows now. But I can't pretend that I am the massive fan, a massive as fan as some of the ladies, and indeed the chaps, that have gone to see literally hundreds of his shows. Hundreds and hundreds of his shows. Oh, Dean wants to say, can you say happy birthday to Dan? Happy birthday, Dan. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Dan. Happy birthday to you. All right. Happy birthday, sir. And indeed, he's coming to do some more concerts here in the UK. It's his farewell tour. He's giving up the touring because, quite frankly, touring is extremely tiring. Now, I'm not a tourer, but let me tell you, I go in and out of London almost every night. I just happen to have the whole weekend off this weekend. And it is tiring. Travelling around is tiring. You imagine that, you know, staying in hotels. The fact that they're 5-star hotels and everything's there for you is neither here nor there. You're still in a hotel away from home. That's how it is. And it's blooming tiring, so he's given up. But before he's given up, he's doing this farewell tour. Now, he's doing it in the States at the moment. And I don't know if you saw one of my shows the other week. Deanna, I think she was the first one. She got picked. She got picked by the great Barry Manilow to go and have a dance with her on the stage. And I said at the time that, you know, your friends will hate you for this. They will pretend that it's okay, you know. Oh, you know, oh, it's really nice for you, Deanna, and all that, you know. But they will actually hate you. They will hate you. Well, it seems that he's going through the whole group here. So now, I think it was last night or the night before, two other ladies from our Barry group, as they're known, the Barry group. Bev was picked on the other day. Just plucked out of the crowd. Are all these front row people? You know, because I'm in the front row at the O2 in London for the last one. How lucky was I to get that ticket before the whole thing went wrong, didn't it? I remember that night. I was actually doing a quiz at the King's Head Theatre Bar. I do this quiz every Wednesday night at the King's Head Theatre Bar in Islington. And on this particular night, the tickets were going on sale at 8 o'clock, and I had my computer, it was all set up ready. 8 o'clock, I start pushing this button frantically. Refresh, refresh, refresh. And it come up, do you want these tickets? Yes. Put in the card, quickly went through and got them. I got them. They're actually here next to me. One moment, please. Collecting tickets. Are you still there, Shania? Rory says the Beatles gave up touring, never said anything, and got away with it. Or it's too much touring all the time. You've got to give up at one point. I mean, Barry's 70-odd, you know. He still manages to dance. He's got, I think he's got a couple of plastic hips and things like that, but he still does it, doesn't he? Where are my tickets? 1 minute. There is somewhere. Look at the mess in here. I did have a dreadful mess. Hello, Daniel. Nice to see you, sir. Daniel, you've said hello on several different places now. What is the problem, dear? I've said hello to you 3 times now. Are you not paying attention, dear? Do try and stay with it. Well, here they are. Barry Manilow, one last time at the O2, Thursday, the 23rd of June, 2016, Block A3, Rows A, Seat 52 and Seat 53. I have my tickets. Is my address on here? Hang on a minute. Nope, there we are. Tickets. Barry Manilow tickets. Front row, dear. Front row, yes. So I've got these in the front row as well. And Barry seems to be picking out people in the front row. I assume Bev was in the front row. I hope you're still with us, girls. I know I was rabbiting on a bit about something else earlier. And we've only just got to this now. Let me turn that off now. So Bev's been. And not only Bev, but Eloise as well. Eloise as well. She's now been picked. And she's had a dance with Barry Manilow on the stage in front of not tens, not hundreds, but thousands and thousands of people. Will it be me next? Or I have to say, ladies, I mean, I don't know how to say this, but, you know, he puts out his arm and you're straight up there. You know, I'm not so easy. I'm sorry, girls. I'm going to have to say it. I'm not so easy. I think Barry's looking. Oh, I get that one there. Easy. And you're straight up there. Oh, no, 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 dear. That's not the right way to do it, is it? You've got to make him work for it, dear. You know, when he says, would you like to dance? Oh, I'm not really sure, you know, Barry. I'll have a think about it. I'll let you know. You know, I think you're all being a little bit too easy. Good evening, Wendy. I think you're all being a little bit too easy, girls. I don't want to just be a knot on the edge of that stage of people that Barry's danced with. Oh, no, I want to be remembered. If he chooses me to dance with him, which I think, I've got a feeling that's a bit unlikely, to be honest. I don't think he's going to ask me to dance with him. But if he does, I don't think I'll jump straight up there. Oh, no, it makes me look far too easy, dear. Easy? Me? Me? Easy? I don't think so, dear. So I doubt very much that it will be me that he asked to dance. But there is another lady. So Bev, Eloise and Deanna, you know, I'm a little bit disappointed with you girls for just running up there as quickly as you possibly could. Honestly, you've got to play a little bit more hard to get than that, haven't you, eh? But actually, there is a lady who's with us tonight, and she's just messaging there. Wendy, I really, really hope that he asks you. You deserve to dance with him. You've been to Underford concerts. Wendy won't mind me telling you that Wendy actually sold her car a couple of years ago so she could go to all the concerts in the UK. She don't go to one or two like me. I'm going twice. I'm going to Cardiff, which is on a Tuesday night, and I'm going to the O2, that's two. But he's got many more concerts than that all over the country. Wendy will go to all of them. All of them. That is a real, real massive fan. I love his music and all that, but I couldn't say that I'm in the same fan league as people like Wendy, and indeed Deanna, and Bev, and many others, and Eloise, and loads, loads more. Lovely Angela, the two Angelas as well. You know, I couldn't see. I would say I was in the same league as them to travel around the whole country and take so much time off work to go and see every single one of his shows. Good luck to you. Good luck to you. And I really hope, Wendy, that he dances with you as well, darling. All right. I think the girls might have left. I kept them having on for so long after telling that story. Let's see. Ross, I'm not reading that out. That's very rude, dear. Let's do some more messages here for you. Ross says he's on a... Well, I will read that out. Ross is on a promise, so he's gone. Peter wants to go and see Barry Manilow. Well, go and buy a bloody ticket then, Peter. Don't be so tight. They're not that expensive. You can get one for 20 quid, dear. I mean, you won't be sitting in the same seat as me. Come on, Peter. I'm not sure who you are, Peter. I'm trying to have a look at your photo. Oh, there you are. Is that you there with the glasses on? Holding a fish. What are you doing with that fish? What are you doing with that poor fish, Peter? Gosh. Call in if you want to. 020-8144-3477. 020-8144-3477. Rory says he loves the Barry Manilow dream duets and hits of the 80s. I like the big ballads. Good morning, it's Wednesday the 27th. I love the big ballads. Right, a couple of messages here. Right, that's that done. 020-8144-3477 is the phone-in number. What else have we got here? Now, talking of holidays, boys and girls, here's something. Are you going to Majorca or Ibiza this year? This was a couple of weeks ago, this story. People are furious at being told they will be hit by a tourist tax of 70 quid when you arrive there. Now, you don't get that in a caravan, dear. We don't get to Haven Holidays and have a £70 tax suddenly shoved on? No. The Balearic Island authorities quietly approved the duty, the new tax, promoting sustainable tourism, dear. Sustainable tourism in March, long after many had booked their breaks. The fees will apply for holidays taken from July the 1st, even if they were booked in advance. That's outrageous, isn't it? How could you just suddenly do that? Slap on an extra... Is that per person? You know, so if you've got a family of four, that's another 280 quid on your holiday. That's a bit unfair, isn't it? The rates, depending on a hotel's star rating, with 1 to 3 star hotels costing €1 a day per person, and 4 and 5 stars, €2. Well, how's that 70 quid then? So €1 a night per person. Hang on a minute, that's not as bad as I thought it was. Honestly, you've got to be careful of those headlines, haven't you? It says it means a family of four with children over 16 could pay up to £70 extra over a... Oh, it's a long story. I must remember to read these stories properly before I start rabbiting away, dear. Yes. Now, I love this story here. Now, this is from one of the newspapers a couple of weeks ago, beginning of April. And it's about Margaret Thatcher. Now, whether or not... Sorry, gang, I was cut off then. Whether or not you like Margaret Thatcher, you'll love this story. It was an icon of its era, a weapon Britain's first woman Prime Minister wielded against opponents and unfortunate ministers alike, boys and girls. Margaret Thatcher's handbag was such a symbol of her single-minded determination that the verb to handbag even entered the Oxford English Dictionary. Now, do you remember Margaret Thatcher's handbag? Do you remember it? Everywhere she would go to this. The lady's not returning. No, no, no. Do you remember that handbag and the blue outfit? I used to love the blue outfit. Anyway, it goes on. A new statue of Lady Thatcher, commissioned at a huge cost to stand outside Parliament, has been mothballed because the sculpture has failed to include the lady's premier legendary accessory. So he's done the sculpture and she hasn't got her handbag. So Carol Thatcher, who's her daughter, has said, no, we're not having any of that, thank you very much. So it's not happening. Good. You can't have Margaret Thatcher without her handbag. Well, here's a picture here. That's how it should be, you see, with a handbag there. Isn't it? Oh, look at all the little love arts going for Margaret. Yeah, and there's a picture of the lady there. That's not her blue outfit, but she always had that handbag. It's outrageous. Outrageous. Johnny Key met a celebrity today. Yeah, call in, Johnny. We want to know what celebrity you met today, Johnny Key. Feel free to call in 020-8144-3477. I'm dying to know who you've met today. I wonder if we can guess. Don't tell me you met Barry Manilow. Has Barry Manilow asked you to do the warm-up for him at his shows? Because he always has an artist. He's got Dave I think he's got Dave Coz on at the moment, who plays saxophone. Maybe he would like a couple of ukulele playlists, Johnny. I think you should contact the Barry Manilow people and ask. He quite likes to have you doing that. You know, when I'm cleaning windows with Barry Manilow and Ray Reynolds and Johnny Key. Hello, Johnny.
Good evening, Chris.
Evening, sir. All right?
Yes, thank you. How are you?
Now, who is this celebrity that you've read, that you've met?
Well, this is embarrassing, Chris, because Ray and I thought we were experts on 50s and 60s night music.
Yes.
And we met a gentleman today called Mike Redway. And we got talking to him. We were actually on the bill with him today. We did a concert over in northwest London.
Right. Mike Redway.
And I've just been looking him up on the internet, and he was a really modest bloke. He had a Water Rats tie on, you know, the charity.
Yeah.
He's a member of the Water Rats, and he told us his name, and we got talking to him, and he recorded with the Burt Bacharach Orchestra.
Yes.
He did the theme tune for the first ever Bond film, Casino Royale.
Right.
He did the demo of Delilah.
For
Tom Jones to get the, you know, to learn the song from.
Yeah.
As well as singing on the backing on it. And he made a career out of making covers on Embassy Records. Remember Embassy Records?
I do remember. What was his name again?
Mike Redway.
The name
R-E-D-W-A-Y.
The name does ring a bell, to be honest.
Yeah?
Yeah, Embassy Records.
Yeah, but he also did a lot of stuff under his own name. He had records out, and so Ray, having been a DJ for 35 years...
And he didn't know.
he didn't pick up on it, and I didn't either, and I've been collecting records since the late 50s.
Oh, no, Ray didn't realise, but Ray knows everything.
Well, Ray started telling him stuff, you know, Ray.
Yeah.
If we mention a name, Ray would say, oh, did you know this, did you know that? I met so-and-so, and... we missed an opportunity because we should have if we'd known more about this bloke beforehand, we could have really got some good showbiz stories out of him.
Adam says he met Sue Pollard on Friday in Eastbourne.
Yeah, I've not met her, but Ray knows her, and yeah. I know he's got very high regard for her.
Heidi High thing, wasn't it? Heidi High, because I met her in the Two Brewers the other day. In Clapham.
But yeah, it's when you were talking about Barry Manilow there, I was just thinking about it, and to have recorded with the Burt Bacharach Orchestra and have all those things on your CV, it's quite impressive, isn't it?
That's pretty amazing, isn't it?
And he was such a nice man, so modest, and after he told us a few things, I said, I feel like I'm rubbing shoulders with the stars today.
There you are, you see.
In a jokey way. And he said, well, I feel the same way about you two.
Well, generally, I've found over the years, and I've met quite a few stars, really, you know, the Supremes, Beverly Sisters, Buck Spheres, Brotherhood of Man, and quite a few others. You remember the guy who did Magpie?
No, I don't.
You remember Magpie?
I don't remember. That was because I was just a bit after my time, Magpie. I'm more of a flowerpot man.
Okay, Magpie. Yeah. His name's gone right out of my head. But I worked with him for a while at a radio station down in Southampton, Play Radio. And he was so nice, such a nice person. And I've generally found those people that are massive and have made it are really nice people, right? Some people who haven't made it and are trying to get there are real pains in the arse. They really are, some of them, and they're just horrible. I met a few of those as well. cool, I could reel out a list of names here of people, you know, that were really not nice at all, and indeed never made it. And I don't think you do made it if you're just such a nasty person.
Well, that's a tricky one, because nice people don't often get on, you know. You've got to be pretty single-minded to be successful these days.
That's why
so many relationships suffer, isn't it?
You need to be, well, yeah, you've got to be single-minded and don't go on the X Factor. Oh, that's finished, isn't it? Do you like that or not, the X Factor?
No, I don't. I used to quite enjoy it when they did the auditions in a little room.
Yeah.
And you get the people going in just singing for 10 seconds or 15 seconds.
Yeah.
But it's so overhyped now. It's all in the theatres.
Yeah.
It's past its sell-by date, I think.
I think so as well. Yeah. I never really liked it. I don't like that whole thing of just being nasty to people, really.
I tell you what, Chris, though. I'm so impressed. They're so clever. They know just what questions to ask the contestants when they come on. Isn't that amazing?
Yeah, funny that, and it's all scripted. Yeah,
have you got a story to tell us, or who did you come with today?
The whole thing is totally scripted. You know that. Yeah,
of course it is.
You know that anyway.
When you're spending thousands of pounds on a TV show, you can't afford to take chances with it being live.
No, I suppose not. But I did prefer The Voice because, you know, they weren't nasty to contestants.
Yeah.
Although
not turning round's pretty nasty.
Well, yeah, I suppose so. But I had people, you know, people come up to me at karaoke nights and say, oh, Chris, I'm so excited. I'm through to around in X Factor. And, you know, some of these people, including myself here, are just karaoke singers. You know, we're just that's as far as it's ever going to go.
Which is not a bad thing in itself. But
no, it's not a bad thing.
Yeah,
it's not a bad thing. But they're not like...
You can't make a career out of it.
But they, like me, are not and will never be pop stars. Mm. And you know that. But that's not what the people from X Factor tell them. They tell them they're in with a really good chance of winning. And it's all lies just to get them on there, on the stage, and take the piss out of them. And I just don't like that, Johnny.
No, I'm with you there.
But the
geezer we met today was the exact opposite. He was, if anything, he was praising our performance and just not really mentioning how good he was.
Well, that's all right, isn't it?
Yeah.
And the way the judges come on the stage in the X Factor, you know, built up to be like some sort of gods.
Yeah.
I mean, who the hell do you think you are? Do me a favour, really. No, it all went wrong when they took off Opportunity Knox, if you ask me, on Dems television.
Oh, New Faces wasn't too bad.
Oh, apart from that awful woman, Nina Mishkoff, she was dreadful.
Oh, what a horrible lady.
She's still alive.
Yeah.
I thought someone would have bumped her off after all her comments.
Well, Tony Hatch could be quite mean at times.
Yeah. Oh, look who's just joined us this evening. Mark's with us tonight. Hello, Mark. Mark Cording's with us, karaoke superstar. Mark Cording is with us this evening. Hello, Mark. Good.
Bit of a Central Station reunion
going on
here.
Well, that's what's going on tonight, I think. Thanks for calling in, Johnny.
Okay, nice to speak to you, Chris.
Absolute pleasure to you. Bye-bye, sir. There we are. Johnny Key, boys and girls, karaoke extraordinaire and very good. He plays the old ukulele and all that business. Very, very good indeed. Now, there's a couple of stories here I was going to read for you. What do you think of this? You ready? We will soon live to 1,000 years. A British scientist has claimed that the secret to preventing ageing may be solved in the near future, and that some people born already may live for up to 1,000 years. The staggering claims were made by a biomedical theorist, this is in the Daily Mail, who has made a name for himself into preventing ageing. He's got a very strange photo. I mean, he's got a beard like this. Oh, I can't bear beards, dear. I can't stand them. Beards. Just dirty. Dirty. Oh, you can have a bit of stubble. Actually, I've got a bit of stubble today. Can you see? Look. Wait, it's double now. Got a bit of stuff. That's okay. You know, even a bit more. But beards that go down here, like Dumbledore. like Dumbledore on the Harry Potter films. Just horrendous. Why would you want this beard? Dead? You know, because imagine you eating tomato soup, it would keep dipping in there, wouldn't it? They're just anyway. This bloke's got a beard, Dr. Aubrey de Grey. Type it into Google and have a look at his picture. Dr. Aubrey, A-U-B-R-E-Y, de Grey. A Harrow and Cambridge educated biomedical. Anyway, he's developing a new form of medicine based on regenerative therapies. Now, I mean, can that make me look young again? You know, can it grow any area? I can't lie to you. I did look once at this stuff in Boots, the chemist. And it was a jar. It was 50 quid, this stuff. I'm going back here in a few years as well. This stuff was 50 quid. And you literally, it says you just rub it on your head. And after so many weeks, new hair will start growing. And then on the back, my God, you know, possible side effects, heart palpitations. If you're allergic to this, if you have kidney problems, don't use it. I thought, my God, this is dangerous stuff, dear. Dangerous stuff. Although there was another thing I've noticed. You can go and have little dots tattooed into your head. Now, what's the name of that company? I think it was called Scalp. S-K-A-L-P, Scalp. And you're going to have little dots tattooed onto your head. I mean, you know, if you went like that, you'd know straight away. But how many people now run their hands from the air? No one, dear. No one. Shall I have it done? Little dots. I could do it myself, couldn't I? Look, put a pen or something like that. He goes on to say, by reconstructing the structured order of the living machinery of our tissues, a tissue, these rejuvenation biotechnologies will restore the normal functioning of the body cells and essential biomolecules, returning aging tissues to health and bringing back the body's youthful vigour. Now, if you're a little bit older, maybe over 50, same as me, you'll know what I mean by youthful vigour, because we don't really have that anymore. We don't worry too much. How can I put this? If we go out and don't pull, it doesn't matter anymore, does it? Do you remember when you were younger? Oh, especially the lads. Lads, do you remember when you were younger? You went out, I haven't pulled tonight, so it has been a disaster. It doesn't matter anymore. You can go out quite happily now, you know, have a cup of tea and come home. But it's fine. Come up and talk to people like yourself. Rory says, I will never have a beard in my case. I know it wouldn't suit me and I'm frightened getting old. What do you mean you're frightened getting old, Rory? You already are, dear. Ancient, dear. Ancient. It goes on to say, the research centre has been criticised by Dr. Tilo Kunath of the Centre for Regenerative Medicine, who's dismissed this fear as incorrect. So maybe it can't happen. But would you want to live to 1,000? Or does that depend on what you'll be like? If I could say to you, you can live to 1,000 and you can be as if you were in your 30s, the way you look, the strength in your body and your general outlook. It would be as if you were in your 30s, okay? If that was the case, would you want to live to 1,000? Or if they couldn't keep you at 30, if they couldn't push you back to 30, and you continued to age as you are now, and again, if you're in your 50s, probably some of the stuff you do is a little bit slower. You know, you get out of bed, all my foot hurts today, all my knee. You know, if that was likely to continue getting worse and worse, would you want to live to 1,000 then, I wonder? Have you got any comments on it? What do you reckon? Call in if you want to and talk to me about that. 020-8144-3477, OK? 020-8144-3477. Or you can Skype in. My Skype in username is all one word, United Kingdom Talk. I don't know. I think if I could continue to sort of do this sort of thing, even if I wasn't perhaps quite as healthy as I was, if I couldn't go on my bike to the shops or walk around or stuff like that. But if I could, you know, even if I couldn't do those things, if I could still come in here, you know, once or twice a week, maybe daily, and have a little bit of a chat to you like this on these little shows, I think I'd be all right going to 1,000. Wouldn't it be wonderful to see what we could, what you and I perhaps can see into the future? But you know, at the moment, we're not going to be here. Now, I would like to hope that I'm still here to see man go to Mars. I'd like to see that. To know that I could still be here in maybe, I don't know what the time scale is, say 150 years, and see us actually start to fly to other planets further than Mars, further than our solar system, like as in Star Trek. I mean, we don't have to be in the spaceship itself, do we? We could just be there would be cameras on the ship, and they would just send the stuff back like a TV show. How fantastic would that be? And then to decide, oh yeah, let's go on holiday, and we're going to that planet, or we're going to that planet. How marvellous. And I would love to see that. I really would love to see that. I think the most I can possibly hope for is to see us travel to Mars and put men on Mars. Like that idea. Anyway, gang, thank you very much to Wendy, who informs me we've got to the end of our hour and a half. And we only get a maximum of our hour and a half on Facebook One Live. OK, so we have to disappear here. Would you like to see peace all over the world? Yes, of course, Peter. I would love to see peace all over the world. Will it ever happen? I doubt that very much. There's too much fighting, and that's the way it is. So I can't see it myself. I can't see peace ever falling all over the whole world. We can have a lot of fun trying, you know, but it's one of those things, Peter. Adam says, I'm 43, overweight, both of my knees have had it, and lack of teeth. We can have all those things fixed, dear. Get yourself down to the dentist to get your teeth sorted out. You can do that. Cost you an arm and leg, mind. I don't know how much they would charge you, NHS or private. I know you can do it in other countries, can't you? You can go to other countries and get your teeth and that done. But I think I'd be more inclined to save up and have it done in this country, really. Well, that's it. Thank you very much today, boys and girls. It's been an absolute pleasure talking to you on this Saturday evening. There'll be another short show tomorrow. And I don't know what I'm doing tomorrow night, so we might well have another little show tomorrow night. OK, boys and girls, thank you very much. And I shall see you soon. Cheerio now.